The Avro Canada CF-105 Arrow was planned to become the first all-Canadian aircraft and the best fighter interceptor in the world. Development began in 1955 as a more powerful version of the Avro Canada CF-100 Canuck, and it was designed to reach Mach 2 speeds at an altitude above 50,000 feet. The Royal Canadian Air Force wanted it to become their primary interceptor, and it even went directly into production, leaving out the prototype phase. But perhaps the program was too costly and ambitious, and the country suddenly faced national security concerns in the face of the Soviet nuclear ballistic threats. No monopoly on genius. In 1944, the Canadian government established an advisory committee on aircraft manufacture. It was determined that establishing a Canadian consolidated aircraft industry was of the, quote, utmost importance to Canada. AV Row Canada Limited was then established as the Canadian branch of the UK-based AV Row and Company. Minister C.D. Howe and the directors of the British Hawker Siddeley aircraft firm signed the deal, and Avro Canada began operations in 1945. The new company would provide repair and servicing of World War II aircraft, including Hawker Sea Fury fighters and Avro Lancaster bombers. The company's first president was Roy Dobson, who was jointly responsible for the Lancaster bomber. It was the beginning of the jet propulsion era, and a team of talented designers and engineers soon joined the endeavor. Avro Canada quickly became a symbol of the future, and at one point was the third largest company in Canada and among the top 100 companies worldwide, employing over 50,000 people. One of its first projects was the C-102 Jetliner, a medium-range passenger jet airliner that the company expected to sell to TransCanada Airlines, later Air Canada. It gained impressive notoriety in April of 1950 when it flew to New York carrying the world's first jet airmail. The New York Times even wrote that, quote, Uncle Sam has no monopoly on genius. But the airline withdrew its support, fearing that it would not be profitable. As the Korean War loomed over, Minister C.D. Howe ordered Avro to fully devote itself to the CF-100 Canuck twin jet fighter interceptor. The all-weather CF-100 entered service in 1953 under new president Crawford Gordon, and it would serve in several roles until 1981. But the trying times of the post-war demanded more. The Soviets threatened to halt the peace in Europe and North America with powerful bombers that outperformed the best fighters in the West. Consequently, the Royal Canadian Air Force issued a request for proposal for a two-crew, twin-engine supersonic interceptor in 1953. The request specifications included a range of 556 kilometers for low-speed missions and 370 kilometers for high-speed interceptions, cruising speed at Mach 1.5, and a service ceiling of 50,000 feet to be reached in 5 minutes after ignition. The turnaround time on the ground needed to be less than 10 minutes, while maneuverability demanded for 2G turns with no loss of speed or altitude. The Royal Canadian Air Force thoroughly analyzed American, British, and French manufacturers, but no existing aircraft could fulfill the requirements, and there were no plans to build such a model. The Arrow would be a highly ambitious project for its time, but the fighter would exceed all expectations. Supersonic. Avro had already conducted extensive research into supersonic aircraft when the request for such an interceptor was issued. The CF-103 was a modification of the CF-100, with swept wings that allowed better transonic performance. But when the straight-winged CF-100 broke the sound barrier in 1952, the model was abandoned. That same year, the company came up with design studies for a delta-wing aircraft, a whole new concept that pushed the design team to solve unprecedented problems. The Delta Wing provided the same advantages as a swept wing in supersonic and transonic flight, but it had more space to store fuel, a pivotal factor for a long-range interceptor. The increased drag at low speeds and altitudes were deemed minimal, as the main purpose of the aircraft was to be a fighter interceptor. Two variants of the C-104 were designed, the single-engine CF-104-4 and the twin-engine CF-104-2. A two-seat version of the CF-104-2 would then be redesignated as CF-105 to comply with the request specifications. The aircraft's delta wing was then mounted on the fuselage shoulders, allowing for quick access to its weapons, engines, and internal components. This configuration also allowed the entire wing to be built as a single piece, which in turn reinforced the airframe. However, there were unforeseen problems. James Floyd, Vice President of Engineering, would recount in the 1980 documentary There Never Was an Arrow how, quote, problems were legion. The difference in temperatures between the wing skin and the fuel at combat altitudes distorted the wing, so they had to be adjusted. In addition, the Arrow was initially powered by Rolls-Royce RB-106 engines, which provided 21,000 pounds of thrust, but Rolls-Royce canceled them in 1954. A decision was made to use the Orenda PS-13 Iroquois turbojet engines developed by Orenda Engines, which were part of the Avro Canada group. These engines would be lighter but more potent, and Floyd recalled that, quote, "We had to be dead right the first time." The program would then adopt the Cook-Craigie plan to meet the timetable. Instead of developing prototypes, scale models were fitted in rockets and tested for aerodynamic performance at Point Pete, Lake Ontario. The models were intentionally crashed in the water after the test runs, but they confirmed the need for minor modifications before the first batch was produced. Improvements included a slight negative camber to the wings, a dogtooth at about half span to control spanwise flow, a drooping in the leading edges of the wings, a sharpening of the nose, and the addition of a tail cone. These modifications were applied to reduce drag at transonic and supersonic speeds, a design technique known as the Whitcomb area rule. Given that the Air Force hadn't carried out studies on the armament suite for the new fighter, Chief Technician Robert Lindley came up with a creative solution. The Arrow would have a detachable bomb bay, capable of carrying any armament. Lindley recalled, quote, "It was a nifty feature." A success. More than 14,000 Avro employees were assigned to the project, and construction began on the steel, aluminum, and titanium airframe in 1956. The governing liberals quickly took notice of the prohibitive costs, and even Minister C.D. Howe stated that, quote, "We've embarked on a program of development that gives me the shudders." In June of 1957, the government switched from liberal to conservative, and John Diefenbaker was appointed prime minister. The new government would then assess the viability of any programs approved by the previous administration, and Avro was under close watch. Still, the Arrow made its first public appearance on October 4th. During the presentation, Minister of Defense George Perks conveyed that, quote, "The aircraft has this one great advantage over the missile. It can bring the judgment of a man into the battle." Unfortunately, the Soviets launched Sputnik 1 on the same day, which overshadowed the Arrow's presentation and officially kicked off the missile age. Despite the odds, the Arrow passed its taxiing test and flew for the first time on March 25, 1958. The first model, RL-201, was flown by Janis Zurakowski. Though it reached only 11,000 feet the first time, following flights confirmed that the years of hard work had paid off, as the fighter reached 50,000 feet at almost twice the speed of sound. Zurakowski later declared that he had never tested an aircraft with such minimal problems. The Canadians were now on the leading edge of aviation technology, with what seemed to be the most advanced fighter of its time. Floyd even sustained that, quote, "It was just unthinkable that anything could go radically wrong with that aircraft." Turmoil. During its first few flights, the Arrow reached above Mach 1 speeds, a feat that Captain Reginald Lane of the Royal Canadian Air Force described as, quote, "a truly incredible accomplishment." Test pilot Peter Cope added that the Arrow actually reached Mach 1.9, and that the Iroquois engine could provide the aircraft with up to Mach 2.4, an unparalleled feat in 1958. Four consecutive models were developed, and the Avro Arrow was getting more expensive. Minister of Finance Donald Fleming explained that the cost of the unit had been estimated at $1 million, but only if a considerable amount of aircraft were manufactured. However, the usefulness of fighter interceptors was quickly decreasing as the Soviet nuclear missiles became a threat, and the Prime Minister announced in September of 1958 that the Arrow program could not be completed. Nevertheless, 37 Arrows would still be built. 5 months later, the project was officially canceled, and the Canadian spirits were shattered. The decision also left over 14,000 Avro employees and about 15,000 other personnel in the supply chain without a job. That day is still remembered as Black Friday. The five existing models were scrapped within months, while an incomplete sixth one with the Iroquois engine is believed to be in a warehouse in Ottawa. There was fear of secret information leaking to the Soviets, with the police even mentioning a mole within the Avro facilities. Crawford Gordon was fired from the company, and the rest of the team was given jobs around the world. Several employees even moved to the US to work on space missions like Mercury and Gemini. The Avro company never recovered and closed its doors in 1962. The revolutionary jet ultimately proved that smaller countries could hardly compete in the jet age, but there's no question that the Avro Arrow pushed technology to its limits. Thank you for watching my video. Don't forget to subscribe to our Dark Documentaries channels and let us know in the comments below your thoughts on the cancellation of such an outstanding project.